This is Ham Radio Now, episode 274. Aftermath, you. After, get it? After Matthew. It's our wrap-up show from Hurricane Matthew. I've been a little disappointed. Oh, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. I've been a little disappointed in the coverage of what I've seen on what happened with Hurricane Matthew in some of the other media. A lot of folks are saying, Hams did a great job, and we deployed, and we were out there, and we did our usual thing. And I've seen some news reports that basically said that, but nobody talks about what we actually do. So this is another EmComm Extra. We've got them kind of piled back to back here. Normally, we're going to space them out a little bit. And we'll talk some about what happened with Matthew. We got a few folks lined up to talk to that were in the thick of things and can describe what they did. But before we get to that, I want to welcome back to Ham Radio Now this fella, David Goldenberg, W0DHG. And David, on the initial EmComm Extra number one, the lead into to Matthew, you kind of appeared sort of as just a guest, as someone who was involved in EmComm, because I couldn't find anybody down in the affected area that could get on camera and talk to me, and I kind of reached out, and there you were. But that's not your role in the EmComm Extra. You are a designated hitter. You're going to be a co-host.
And yeah, that's great, and I'm looking forward to it, Gary.
Yeah, so you're going to be on here regularly. Let's tell people who you are. Give me your title again.
Sure. So I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. I'm a EC with ARES, the LAX, Los Angeles area, Northwest section, one of the four sections in the Los Angeles area. In addition to that, I actually recently added net manager to my title, so I do scheduling and tracking of the nets here.
Yeah, I got a little confused as we were talking about ECs and stuff, because I'm used to ECs being basically county-based.
Yeah, in the Los Angeles area. Yeah, in the Los Angeles area, there are so many people and so many things to do. That's a good picture of our county, that we're broken up into four sections. Each has a section manager, and then in the individual sections, there are a number of ECs, and we break them out into to smaller areas to manage the different missions we have. So I work with a number of hospitals in the West Valley. Yeah, kind of where the mouse is there, the Western San Fernando Valley, and each of the different ECs. So I'm a little higher up into the, there you go.
There we go.
Each of the different ECs work with, again, our mission's mostly hospitals based. We work with the hospitals and the other volunteers in the organization.
Okay. So, it's just because there's so many darn people out there.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
absolutely. North Carolina is this whole state of North Carolina, 375 miles wide, is one section.
Right.
You guys have an ARL section that's part of a county.
It is the county, actually. The LAX section is the county of Los Angeles.
All right.
and then we break it up internally in the area. You know, we have one section manager, but then they've decided to break that up into a number of areas. Just part of it's just logistics. It's Los Angeles County is huge.
Yeah. And I used to live in the second city in Chicago, which used to be the second largest city in the U.S. And then L.A. took over from that a couple decades ago. So let's talk about this show a little bit. I don't even remember which one it was. Hey, everybody. Ham Radio Now, episode 249, EmComm. EmComm? Just EmComm? Little generic there, isn't it, Gary? But I think it was when I was introducing the guys down in Charlotte. Emergency communications, relationships with, and expectations of served agencies. Ah, that caught my attention. That's Mike Patterson. He's KG4PDA, the Emergency Disaster Services Director for the Salvation Army of the Carolinas. And then the guy in the little window over here is Greg Hauser, W3FIE. And Greg is... Well, I've got down here with the communications division of the Charlotte, North Carolina Fire Department. And ahead of that, I think I talked about my wish of doing a regular MCOM program, and that I'd be looking for some motivated co-hosts. And I believe you responded to that.
Yeah, actually, I think you waited until the end of that show.
Oh, that's right. I wanted to
pull it out just to see if you'd had any people that actually got to the end of the show.
Okay, so if you're hanging in here with me, I want a co-host for this show. I want somebody to do the show with me. So consider this to be a casting call. Yeah.
And I was actually on vacation in Sedona at the time. And girls were taking a nap and my wife was out and sat down to catch up on some work. And I opened up my laptop to listen to the show, and it was a good show. And then I got to the end and I thought, okay, well, I've been interested in doing something like this and, you know, having to help the voice of amateur radio out there in a positive way beyond the stuff that I'm doing with the section. And so I thought, okay, we'll try it out.
And
I'm glad to be.
And your on-air tryout was the Hurricane Matthew heading on into it. And and you did great.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. And you know, I know you tried to reach out to folks there, and my assumption was that everybody there was scrambling to get all their stuff together and ready.
Yeah, well, I'd like to talk about that a little bit more generality in a moment. So I guess we were starting to talk about what we'd like this program to become. And I thought, okay, we're going to burn content. We should just talk about it to the audience.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because we're going to attract hams like you and one of the fellows that we're going to talk to in a moment. I'll admit we pre-recorded an interview with Scott Roberts, KK4ECR. He's an AEC and a PIO down in the Jacksonville, Florida area. And he will talk about how he got into ham radio for MCOM. And you were saying you kind of got into it for the same reasons. You're an MCOM centric ham. Is that a fair description?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and I kind of fell upon this, you know, it was something that was interesting a long time ago to me. But once it came to the code requirement when I was, I don't know, 18 or 20 years old, there were other things to do. And we put on a cert program 6 or 7 years ago at the elementary school where I was a board member and my kids went. And after that was all done, I thought, well, there's got to be other stuff to do. And I did a couple things with that group and ran into some hams there and talked to them. And, you know, I've always been into technology, and that seemed like something cool and fun. And so the next class I could sign up for, I went and got my tech ticket, and that kind of started it all. And It was a good group. Actually, it was run through our sheriff's department here, the amateur radio test in the class. It's all kind of a one day with a couple of follow-ups. And they gave gave kind of a spiel at the end while we were waiting for them to grade our tests. And they had somebody from the DCS group, the Disaster Communication Service, and they work dedicated with the sheriff's department. He came up and, you know, in his uniform, and you've got to get a uniform, and you got to do this, and we do training, you got to put in a number of hours every month. And the next guy came along, Chris Seitz, WA6VHA, and he said, you don't have to have a uniform, and we'll ask you to do a little bit of training, but we'll help you with that. And you come when you can come. And we're a big group and a bunch of fun guys. And so I went up, I got his card, and, you know, the next month I was at the meeting, and look, I sit here now.
Yeah. So this was your entry into ham radio, but it's not your life. It's not everything you do in life.
Oh, no, not at all. And I joke with that. The number one thing I do is I'm a scoutmaster for a Boy Scout troop, and I have my three kids, and then I got another 60 boys. That doesn't pay either. I've been doing technology, information technology, in the Southern California area for, I don't know, 25 or 30 years, kind of date myself there. Right now I'm actually working primarily disaster recovery and business continuity for an entertainment company.
Of which there are many in the Los Angeles area.
There are a lot.
So you can hook me up with getting a star thing somewhere.
You know, it's funny. So the company I work for, we're actually one of the largest employers of record in the state of California. But we're mostly HR and payroll and insurance and stuff like that. We don't actually do the shows. We employ the people, and then they do the shows, and we pay them and do all the bookwork.
I've gotten checks from a big company that does payroll and stuff.
Oh, that's probably stars. that's probably That's probably the one.
Yeah. It was called Spotlight.
Oh, no, no. No, it's, out of Chicago, the company I work for, the company I work for is called Entertainment Partners.
Yeah.
Yeah. They've been in the business for about 4 years.
Like Spotlight. And I think they changed their name, but they were out of Chicago, I think. Yeah, I used to, I did a little bit of voiceover work on the national scale for Travelocity.
Okay.
And just lucked into that. I've told the story on the show before. I think I don't go through the whole thing again, but I was engineering recording session and they were looking for an announcer to go with the little gnome guy and weren't getting what they wanted from the folks that were auditioning. And the producer was kind of getting exasperated. And I'd done some voiceover stuff, we call them scratch tracks. You record the copy so that the editor's got something to edit to, and then you go get the real high-priced announcer and then put them in. And I'd done some of those, and they still try to make them sound right. So I said, well, let's give it a try. And so I ended up going, Travelocity presents the... I'm holding my hand over my ear the way Gary Owens did, even though I'm wearing earphones. Travelocity presents the roaming gnome, denouncer of travel myths. And got the gig for 2.5 years, lots of money.
That's great.
It paid for all this stuff.
That's awesome.
And the stuff in my car. So, yeah. So I'm ready for my close-up, Mr. DeMille.
Yeah. Well, you keep at it.
Keep working at it.
Yeah, well, you know, I know you've been looking for some more equipment for some of the tapper stuff. So there you go.
Yeah. What the heck are we going to do with this show?
So, yeah, you know, I've been watching a number of podcasts. I a lot of drive time in the Los Angeles area, you know, an hour a day each way pretty much. And so I don't watch so much, but I listen to a lot of the podcasts, amateur radio, technology and whatever. And I definitely think there's an opportunity to dive a little more into EmComm. Nobody's really doing it. There are a lot of good programs out there, but really talking about, you know, what it is and the mission. We talk about the equipment, we talk about training. The guests we have today are, you know, real actual responders, and we're actually in the field this month doing great things and, you know, talking to people like that have responded to things. There's nothing like experience to really be able to talk about, you know, what went well and what didn't go well. So I think those are the kinds of things. And, you know, there are other opportunities. I know I have access to a couple of communications, trucks or trailers out here that we can look at, and then guests, you know, all across the country, there are people that work with ARES and other groups as well, that we could bring in and talk about, you know, what's their specific mission. Cause I know every mission's different.
Got to remember which buttons I'm supposed to push to put myself on camera here. I'm doing the switching here as well. This is a one man band operation I get occasionally lost in the configuration here. So this button that I'm about to push puts a split screen. Yeah. Love it. Sure. When I can predict what happens when I push the button. When I got started with this, ham radio TV stuff, the online ham radio TV stuff, my first introduction to it was Ham Nation. And after we'd done a couple shows, I started on somewhere the sixth show or something, filling in for Bob Heil. And at Hamfest, people would say, well, you know, it's cool, but you're going to run out of things to say in 50 shows.
Yeah, I don't think so.
This is Ham Radio Now, episode 274.
Yeah.
So, and narrowing it down to EmComm, I'm going to give us 10,000 shows before we run out of things to talk about.
If we all last that long, that would be great.
Yeah, because there will be actual, you know, the breaking news things like Hurricane Matthew that went through. That we'll want to talk to people about, but most of the time there won't be something like that.
Well, I think there'll always be something that comes up to be able to go and reach out and find people. You know, I know a couple months back they did a big drill in the Pacific Northwest, the Cascadia Rising, and you know, talking about even those kinds of things and, you know, what they found. I know everybody does things different. You know, the guests we're going to talk to, Scott, today, they're, you know, UHF, VHF, and mostly analog. And that's what we do as well. But I know there's a lot of other groups out there that are providing other services. Like Marty, we spoke to last time, they're doing a lot of microwave stuff and bringing, you know, phone lines in and IP into the EOC or into at least some of the race stuff that they're doing. there are a lot of different missions, a lot of different opportunities to talk about what do we do in EmComm, and it will spur ideas for other groups to be able to say, wow, well, we should be looking into that, or people may reach out to us to say, hey, well, let's come and talk about the thing that we're doing. I know in San Diego and other areas, the Arden Network, and I don't remember exactly what it stands for, but it's kind of an extension of the ham LAN or ham broadband. What was originally a lot of the Linksys wireless routers, which is now mostly running on Ubiquiti equipment and being able to send 2.4 and 5 gigahertz and other spectrums as well, other frequencies as well, you know, long distance to provide big backbounds so that we can have bring internet into places and bring phone service into places and some of the digital, like the laptop based modes.
Yeah, I think Arden is deployed south of you in the San Diego area.
Yeah, there's a huge infrastructure there.
Yeah, they did a presentation at the Tapper conference, which happened last month at St. Petersburg, and I have that recorded. I haven't put it online yet, but we'll find out what that's all about. Also, the HamWAN system, which is another 5 gigahertz system.
Yeah, so, last year at our convention here in the LA area, they had a good presentation there, and that was one of those standing room only packed rooms, and it was a really good presentation. Yep. So I'm looking forward to see what they talked about at Tapper this year.
Yeah, and the timeline is going to get screwed up here. I'm going to try to not destroy the universe by saying that episode 273, which I haven't recorded yet, haven't recorded the introduction yet, is going to be the top official from FEMA. Ted Okada is their chief technology officer, and he made a talk at Tapper. And so you in the audience have seen that before this got online, about a day before. And so you can see what's going on there. So a lot of interesting stuff in the EmComm, and there's other EmComm related stuff from the Tapper conference. So the guys getting excited about building new technology and incorporating it into their EmComm operations. It's quite a driver.
Yeah. And I think there will be, like you said, there'll be a wealth of different topics and information and people to bring on. So I think it'll be a good opportunity. I think you'll be able to generate more than a handful of shows.
Yeah. No problem there. When you're talking about Cascadia Rising, I'm going, I want to do a show on that. I was so busy wrapped up with other things that I couldn't leap on it immediately and make it part of one of these. But once we get rolling, I'm thinking fairly regularly once a month. And
sure.
And there'll be stuff that'll be going by that will say, we really want to do an EmComm show on this, and just be too busy doing other stuff. But I'll try to make that a priority, and maybe do most of them Facebook Live or YouTube Live or both if I can figure out how. So
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah. I like doing live.
I've seen you do a couple of those, and I know the last one we did was Facebook Live, and you know, just another way to get the media out there.
Yeah. I've got to get a little more title technology and stuff built into my Wirecast so that I can get those titles on as we're doing the show. Right now I do it all in post-production.
Right.
In some previous programs, not necessarily specifically EmComm related, but and mostly publicity related, but publicity that involved EmComm quite a bit. The late Bill Pasternak, WA6ITF, down in your area. Did you ever meet Bill?
Nope.
Yeah, he was up in Hollywood, but you know, you live in a small town. I'm surprised you didn't run into each other at a radio club somewhere.
Yeah.
We commiserated about the lack of good media. And often, I guess primarily, media that would come out of EmComm stuff. It's almost impossible to get good pictures. It is absolutely impossible to get good video. And just getting people to get on and talk about what it is they really did. QST, months to almost years after a significant event, will have a fairly detailed rundown. But to me, it's all boilerplate type stuff and very little situational detail. Very little, here's what I did, here's what we sent, here's how we put the equipment together, things like that. And I'm looking forward to bringing people in and grilling them on that, getting them past the boilerplate, past the routine stuff that everybody tells everybody, and really see how this worked.
Yeah, I think that would be great. And, you know, we have the same challenge down here. You know, we do field day and we send out all of the, you know, the press releases and whatever. And actually, 2 or 3 years ago, there was one of the local news stations showed up and actually did a great, you know, 45-second piece on the nightly news about amateur radio in the community. I'll send you a link to that later on. And, you know, we made the news, but it's not very often. And then a lot of times, too, when we're out there drilling or actually responding to an emergency, it's like, who's going to man the camera? Oh, wait, that's not the mission. So we don't do it. And there are a couple of guys in our group and our organization who are always got the camera and always behind the camera, and they do great pictures. And so there's a lot of times there is a good after set of pictures of people doing what they're doing, but mostly stills and not a lot of video. And, you know, we'll put slideshow together and we'll show it at an event, but it doesn't really make it outside of our circle.
Yeah. And that I like to see those.
Yeah, I'll send you some links.
When I look at what Newsline does in their video on Ham Nation, what Ham Nation does, we see a lot of pictures of the disaster from the hurricane. You know, we saw floods, we saw palm trees waving in the wind and buildings damaged and destroyed, but we didn't see hams doing ham stuff.
Well, I don't think CNN's out there looking for us, but they're looking for those video clips. And it's great that we have that wealth of the library that the Ham Nation guys are able to go out there and grab the stuff from whatever the TV station is that's putting out there. Yeah. But I don't think that media is out there looking to see hams and what they're doing or how they're doing it, unless you really get out there and get in their face or have a good contact.
But I would hope Newsline, you know, Don Wilbanks and the guys and Bob and George and the guys on Ham Nation would look more for the ham pictures rather than show another gas station canopy being blown down. Let's see, show the hams. They did a little bit of that. They had a news clip from a TV station.
What I wanted to do is to play this really great video that was done on WTVY. It's a television station that did a great piece of video. Usually their reports are not very good. This was great because it's all about ham radios.
Sometimes ham radios are all we have. WTVY's Dylan Huffman tells us how this technology is helping out during the storm.
When severe weather hits, these guys in Dafuniak Springs are ready.
We are standing by to pass any information or vital traffic related to Hurricane Matthew at this time.
Volunteers are all over the state working with ham radios, trying to help in any way they can.
But it's what I call the boilerplate stuff. It's the, here's what hams do, and, you know, we're always digging in. Way too often, people say first responders, and we're not first responders.
Nope.
And don't, you know, if we're trying to gin up excitement, I'm of the opinion we don't want to gin up excitement. Enthusiasm, yes. Excitement, no.
Right. Absolutely. We don't go in guns blazing or anything else. You know,
antennas show up waving.
No. Well, I mean, they may be depending on how fast you come in, but yeah, no, we're not the first responders. We're there to help, and they'll let us know when they want us to activate, and we'll go in there, and hopefully we get the right mix of technical talent and somebody that's able to go and interface with the rest of the ICS command structure and know our place and be able to say, yes, we can help and we'll provide that service and not be very pushy and say, oh, we're here to save the day and rescue everyone.
Yeah. Cause that's not what we do. I'm going to use the phrase glorified telephone operators.
Sure. I mean, if that's what they need and, you know, we're good at communications, that's what we practice. And if we got to pick up a phone or have a radio act like a phone, then I'm willing to fulfill that.
Yeah. I say that just as clickbait a little bit, just to get people's dander up a little, but the 911 operators, the telecommunicators, they're not often accorded a lot of glory. You know, it's kind of a background job. And we are somewhat parallel to doing that. Mm-hmm. Although, and with an element of our technical ability to bring equipment in where things aren't working and make it work.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, and then on the other side of that too, you know, we love to tell people, especially new folks, you know, get a smartphone app and get access to one of the scanners and listen to the fire dispatch and the police dispatch and listen to the job that those people do, because they're real pros. I mean, and they're getting paid for it, right? So, you know, professional is right. And they have the ability to be succinct and get the message across quickly and accurately without a lot of the other rag chew stuff, right? And we get there, right? And that's part of the training, and that's part of the reason why we drill. And we want to have some fun too, but it's really good to listen to those you know, professional people and to work with them to see really how well they manage the airwaves.
Yeah. So I'm going to keep trying to dig out the stories from people. What did you do? How did you do it? How well did it work? What didn't work? You know, it's 2016. Should we have figured all this out by now? Should we be really good at it? Should we be better than we are?
It's hard to know, because, you know, it's the response to a disaster. You never know what it's going to be, you know, and it changes every time. And yeah, sure, the hurricane hit land and we had a flood here, and or there's an earthquake or there's a fire, but it's never the same place and it's never the same time and it's never the same people. We probably should have a really good, you know, model of you need this and you need that and you need the other thing. But remember, too, at least for my organization, we're all volunteers and we're getting paid. And for the most part, nobody's providing us any equipment. So it's what I'm willing to put together and the other people in my section are willing to put together, and across the country, what they're willing to put together. You know, Scott said, the gentleman we had the interview with today, that they have a very standardized deployment box. And so somebody's got to have the funding for that. And I think that's awesome that you show up and it's the same radio and the same power supply and all the other parts that go along with that. But, you know, not in my county, it's not going to work that way. And it might help, but to me, as long as I know how to operate my stuff and I can help someone else who shows up to have the skill set to be able to operate my stuff, and everybody that shows up at each different location that we go to, we'll get the mission done.
Yeah. So you were mentioning before that one of the things we can do on this show is bring people on from all over the country. And I was going to mention the league, ARL headquarters too. You know, they're welcome to participate. Love to have you guys participate. I'm kind of disappointed that they, in fact, don't have this show on as QST.
Sure.
No, they've got the name QSTV. I keep telling them QSTV.
Yeah.
Guys.
Well, they'll get there. They'll get there.
You know, they should be doing something like this. But I'm happy to do it as long as they're not. And even if they did, well, I would take a different approach, because they would take the corporate approach. They would have to. And
right.
You know, and you're under the ARL umbrella.
Yes, I am. Yes, I am. But I'm a volunteer, so
yeah.
I'm gonna have fun with you.
Not saturated with the Kool-Aid.
Well, you know, it's there, and we'll drink the parts that we want and not. And you know, I can talk to some of the other folks in my section and see if, you know, some of those other folks want to come on and talk at, you know, at a higher level than I am. That would be a good start into us.
Yeah.
Give us some folks.
So we didn't discuss this, but I'm kind of flooded with communication about things that people want to do on the show. Can I point people to you who want to participate in the show and make you sort of the producer for the segment producer as we move forward?
Sure, absolutely. Send me the stuff, and then we'll bounce ideas back and forth and see what happens. And the only thing I'll warn you is if it's coming to me and there's stuff that's like live and hitting and happening right now and we can get somebody on, I'm gonna hit you up to go live.
Well, I'll do my best.
Yeah,
I'll absolutely.
Yeah, and it'll be the same thing with me. I've got to figure out carrying around my my headset and my my MacBook so that wherever we could go live. I'm not here at home all the time to be able to have the beautiful studio shot I have behind me, but we'll try to be portable and able to hit this away.
The technology is in our favor. You know, we'll Facebook Live, Periscope, even YouTube is going to get on more of that, and to get us out to do stuff more as it breaks.
Yep.
We can't emulate CNN. Sorry.
No, and I don't think we want to, but some of the pieces, like, you know, like I said, I have a next month we have a statewide hospital disaster drill, and we'll be out and about, and, you know, I take the day off work, and we go out and, you know, like I like to say to the friends and family that don't understand amateur radio, I'm going to go play radio today. And it's not really playing, but that they understand that.
Yeah.
And I'll see what I can do to capture some video and some lessons learned and figure out how to turn that into partially a possible episode.
Yeah. And I'll be relying on you for the expertise in a lot of this, but there's expertise and experience from people all over the country that'll be different than yours. So you'll be learning right along with me. And I'll mention that I have been involved in ARES. I was more deeply involved in previous years. Not at all when I was in Chicago. In that era, up through the end of the 70s, although FM and repeaters were an obvious tool, the local ARES folks were not really embedded in them, didn't use them very much. But that came later when repeaters became even more ubiquitous. When I moved to North Carolina in 1990, I started getting involved in it, mostly as PIO, the public information guy. And back in those days, security was not very tight. I could walk in and out of the EOC, the state EOC in Raleigh, pretty much at will. You know, go back into the station and play with it and stuff. And but I had a hard time getting buy-in from the ECs, and the section manager that brought me in as the state PIC at the time was all about publicity, but getting his ECs on board was more difficult, even as SECs. They didn't really warm up to the idea of getting a lot of publicity. Some of it was just, well, we're not in it to get publicity. Right. And there's plenty of arguments to be made about that.
Yeah, I think in our area, the time that's spent, I'll say advertising, is less advertising and more relationship building with the EOCs and the first responders, the police and fire. And there's probably not a lot of spare time to be working on the advertising so that, you know, the nightly news knows that we're there and ready to come to someone's aid. It's enough that we're, you know, forming those relationships so that police and fire and other officials, the hospitals, know that we're there and we'll respond and help out in a way that they need us to do it.
Yeah. Well, that's the job of the PIO.
Yeah.
And which I consider to be a full-time job, and a lot of times doesn't end up being a full-time job, even if a group has a PIO. So
yeah, and we're short of that.
Yeah. Speaking of which, the fellow that we've been talking about, Scott Roberts, KK4ECR, is both an assistant EC and a PIO. He's wearing a couple hats. So let me switch the feed here, and let's talk to him for a little bit. Scott, welcome to Ham Radio Now.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm very, very excited about it.
And I believe, if I've got this correct, you are the assistant EC and the public information officer for Clay County ARES. I got your correct. All of your job hats.
I've got them sitting behind me, and I'll put them on as I need them.
All right. Clay County is the county that surrounds, what, Jacksonville, Florida?
We are just outside of Jacksonville. We cover Orange Park, Middleburg, Keystone Heights, a few of those cities in that area. So we work with the Clay County Emergency Operations Center in conjunction with Duval County, but we are outside of Duval County.
And when Hurricane Matthew was approaching landfall, the landfall was actually way up in South Carolina, I think. But you guys got
there
lashed.
Was a landfall up there. The nice thing about it is the hurricane did shift to the east, kind of at the last minute. We were expecting more of a direct hit into Clay County. At one point, I think they had determined that it was going to come in near Green Cove Springs, which is part of Clay County. And they were really concerned about the eye wall coming in there. I wish I were a meteorologist and could understand that a little bit better. But they were concerned that it was going to come in at that point. So that's kind of where we were left. But it did miss us by, I guess, about 30 miles.
30 miles is not really very far. And your Skype is frozen again, but we'll see if it pick back up. That's the way Skype works. 30 miles is not far enough to get you in the clear. You still got lashed pretty hard, I imagine.
We did. We had some pretty good wind, and we had some trees down in our area, power out, you know, but all in all, we didn't have as much damage as it was there along the coast.
So Scott, when you guys activated, I know that the ARL said that the whole state of Florida was activated from an ARES perspective. When you guys activated, tell us about what you did, how many people came out, and where were you located? What did you guys do?
Well, the way that our county works is we use a system called Ready Alert, and that allows us to send a text message, an email, and a voice message to all of our members, to whatever numbers they have registered. So we send out an alert to tell them that our county has been activated at the request of our emergency manager. And at that point, we convene a net on our ARES frequency here in Clay County. At that point, a couple of us went to the Emergency Operations Center for a briefing to find out exactly what they were going to ask of us. At the first start, they wanted to open up three shelters. One of those would have been a special needs shelter for those that needed any kind of a special need for medical. And then a couple of general population shelters. One was pet friendly. At the last minute, they decided to open up a fourth shelter. So we had a couple of people at our emergency operations center. Then we had members at four shelters. All in all, we had 15 members that activated, covering the Orange Park Medical Center, the Clay County Sheriff's Office, as well as four shelters in the EOC.
All right, very good. And mostly UHF, VHF?
That is correct. Everything that we did was UHF, VHF. We did have HF capabilities at a couple of our locations, but for this, it was not needed.
Uh-huh. And what kind of services were you providing?
All of our services are in the event that communications are lost. Our Emergency Operations Center did ask that we pass information on shelter status reports. So we took an ICS 213 and modified it to have the body be a standard body. So the information being passed from our shelters was standard, with things like the number of guests, the number of police officers, fire department, how many of on our special needs shelter, how many of them were on oxygen, how many were required electricity, different things that the Emergency Operations Center wanted for statistical purposes. We would collect that every hour so that we knew how many people were coming and going from the shelters.
So when you guys have passed that around, so you said 15 people activated. Is it all voice, or are you doing digital modes, or how are you passing the traffic back and forth?
For this event, we did everything by voice. So we took four shelter survey reports every single hour for the duration of the event. I forget what the total number of reports was, but I sorted through them the other day to make sure that I had a copy of everything. And we passed quite a few. We are putting things together and preparing so that the next time that we have an event like this, we are able to do everything digital using WL2K and packet through our packet radios.
Is Clay County a coastal county? Are you right on the coast?
No, we are not right on the coast. We're off the coast by several miles. We do have a couple of rivers. A good sized lake. There's a couple of lakes around, but we are not that close enough to the coast to be of that much concern.
Okay. So you didn't have a flooding issue.
No, we did not.
Yeah. No. Which I guess is the big thing, along most of the coast. Was there a, communications outage at all, or did most of the conventional communication systems, keep on working?
Most of the conventional systems did keep on working. There were a few phone glitches, through the event, where it was convenient that we did have amateur radio at the shelters to pass the information. But for the most part, the main communication cell phones maybe got a little bit busy, but I don't think that we had any outages per se that would have been considered an official outage.
Okay. So when you do the communications with the shelters, that is more just to keep your hand in the game and keep involved rather than just totally being a standby part of the operation.
That's correct. It is. And it also, takes a little bit of pressure off of the, other members at the EOC from having to make those phone calls and keep on top of that. It frees them up to do other tasks that they need to get done.
Okay. And you said you were at the EOC itself, right?
That is correct. I was.
Is it a madhouse?
You know, to start off with, it was a little bit busy. But as things got in place, it calmed down quite a bit, and everybody kind of got into their routine and into their groove, and things went very smoothly. They allowed for they've got facilities there for sleeping and eating. They've got a nice sized kitchen, and so there were able times to take breaks, get away. But for the most part, everything ran smooth. There were no real chaotic times at all. It was a good event for not having anything catastrophic go on.
Yeah. You had said that you were looking forward to doing some digital stuff in the future. This was an entire voice event. Was it all FM, or do you guys make use of any of the digital voice modes?
No, we did not use any of the digital voice modes. We do have access to Fusion and access to DMR, but we stayed FM on this one, so that all of our not all of our members have all the digital modes. So we went with the modes that everybody has. So since everybody has FM, we stayed with that common denominator to make communications work.
Yeah, David, I think we talked about this during the pre Matthew talk or show, that we're kind of stuck still with least common denominator modes.
Yeah, you know, everybody's going to have analog, and you know, most of your equipment, if it does support a digital mode, it'll fall back to analog if you need it, and you don't want to have to depend on the backbone. You guys were lucky that you didn't have any failures in terms of communication, but once you get on that backbone, then everybody has to switch back, and you know, you may miss people here and there.
Yep.
Do you have an idea of about how many people hit the shelters, and were they from your county or from surrounding counties that were more affected?
I don't know from what counties they were, and a rough estimate was we had about a little over 500 people use the four shelters, which we were very pleased that went so well and that we were able to help out with that. I think for our county, with not having an event like this in, I think they said over 10 years, I think things went very smooth, and our county officials did a great job of making sure that those were staffed with the right people to make sure everything was covered.
And who runs that? Is it the Red Cross primarily?
No, actually the Red Cross kind of supported. It's actually handled by our Department of Emergency Management out of Clay County.
Okay. And you guys are in the EOC. Are you permanently set up there?
We do have a permanent setup there. We've got a room there with a couple of computers, an HF radio, VHF radio. We have a packet station there so that we can do packet. That's usually up and running all the time when we want to access it. But we've got a decent setup there. Always room for improvements, but that's something that we're working on as we go on.
Yeah, of course, of course. And then in the field, you said you guys were at several different. Is it people bring their go boxes or vehicles, or kind of varies depending on who goes where?
Kind of varies depending on who's where. For the most part, it was go boxes, and we've got portable antennas. Most of our shelters already have UHF, VHF antennas, so we can take our go kits in there and plug right into those. But in most cases, everybody carries a spare antenna. Some people will crossband off their automobile if necessary. So it's a kind of a wide variety of setups, but we're trying to standardize those as much as possible so that from one shelter to another, everybody knows what's going on. And if there's a problem with the radio, it can be assessed and fixed.
Yeah, that's great. You have those antennas in place. What kind of locations are there that you're able to do that?
Most of these are schools. We've got junior high and high schools that we have set up. And again, our county emergency management has helped us get antenna locations on all of those buildings. So they've run antenna cable for us, put the antennas up. Most places, the antenna wires coiled up in the attic or in the ceiling above a tile, and pop the tile out, drop the antenna down, and things are good to go.
Do you keep a power supply in on site as well? And no radio, I guess.
Most of the locations, we don't have a power supply. Those usually come from the members. Our sheriff's department and our Orange Park Medical Center, those both have permanent radios that are already there, ready to go. So they can be turned on and they're active right away. But for the schools, we don't leave any equipment there except for the antennas. And everybody brings a power supply. In some cases, we had one guy that was working off of deep cell marine batteries. So we've got a wide variety of people in our organization that have a good set of equipment that are ready to do this. And we do practice it and train for it all the time.
Did you have a power outage in a general area?
We did have power outages. Our emergency operations center ran on generator power for a good time. Several of our schools ran on generator. One of the schools actually had to go to a secondary generator because the main generator failed. So we did have power outages in the area that lasted over a couple of days. So we were in all of our locations. We were prepared for that, either packing, hooking up to extra batteries, vehicles, or to a secondary generator if necessary.
You're the state EOC, and the capital of the state is Tallahassee. Am I right?
That is correct.
Yeah. Did you guys communicate up there very much?
We did not for this event communicate to the state EOC over radio. There were a few emails that were sent back and forth, but nothing to basically this event was handled on a county level and everything was done through the county. So we handled it that way and nothing had to go to the state EOC for this.
We were making a little bit of fun of the Florida HF 75 meter frequency during our show that we did as the hurricane was bearing down. Because when we tuned in, we heard rag chewing. You know, good old boys.
Yes.
Although they were saying they were quite aware that this frequency was the MCOM frequency for the state. But it sounds like you said you had HF at your county. It sounds like that didn't get used very much.
No, for this event, it didn't get used. We did kick on and listen to some of the rag chewing that was going on, but since it was just that, we didn't worry about it. And at this point we didn't need it. So we weren't that concerned about it.
Okay. So we weren't participating in a regular net. We didn't listen any farther. I didn't listen any farther after that, to see if anything came up.
To my knowledge, nothing of consequence came up over that net, for this event. They were there if we needed us and if we needed them rather. And, we knew that, but, for this event, everything went smooth enough that we didn't require any additional assistance than what we already had in place.
Okay. For both of you guys, back to the digital voice on VHF, have you guys had discussions in your areas about incorporating digital voice? You probably have advocates for every single mode, you know, piping up now and then, but where's it go?
Well, I'm a big one on DMR. I actually have a DMR repeater, that is at our hospital. We've got a couple of guys that have bought into, fusion repeaters and, here you go. That's good. I've got one of those and I've got a Motorola 7550. I love DMR. I've got one in my vehicle. Our Orange Park Amateur Radio Club just bought two fusion repeaters. They've put one up on UHF, and they've got one that they're going to be putting up on VHF, and they're going to put them in mixed mode. We've got several people that have fusion radios. So there is talk about using that in the future, but it hasn't rolled out far enough at this point for it to be used in an emergency situation.
Yeah. Well,
yeah, go ahead.
I was gonna say, be direct and critical. Could you ever get all the cats herded toward one system, or is there a way to use multiple systems? Is there any way to get there, and is there a reason to try?
I'll go it this way. the digital modes are basically a tool in the belt. They do, in my opinion, they've got their place. I think that they can be useful under some circumstances. But when it comes down to an actual emergency where communications goes out, honestly, your direct simplex modes, are going to be the way to go. During an emergency situation, I don't really see how, a digital mode is going to be of a benefit, other than the fact that, maybe you can get your signal a little farther because the digital's not using as much bandwidth or something along that lines. But for the most part, it's really going to end up being your simplex analog communication that really does the job and gets it done.
Yeah, I think you mean FM and repeater as opposed to simplex, although.
Well, no, not necessarily, because we did for our shelters. We did have simplex as a backup and did test it and had communications with all of our shelters on simplex without the use of repeaters, because one of the concerns was, do we have communications if our repeaters go down? In this event, our repeaters never went down, but it's there.
Yeah. And I'll, I'll reinforce that too. And in the LA area, you know, in each one of our, you know, subsets, you know, there's the Los Angeles area and then the San Fernando Valley. Most of the stuff we plan for and drill on, yeah, we use a repeater so we can talk to everybody. But when we actually do a drill or when there's a live event, we're mostly focused on simplex, and we'll locate folks up in the hills that overlook those areas to be able to expand out the signal and the footprint. Because again, you know, we don't know, our issues here are mostly earthquakes. And after an earthquake rolls through, you don't know what hilltops are still up and running. And they do have backup power, but you can't always rely on it.
And David, how goes the digital battle among your constituents?
We're staying away from it for now. You know, Los Angeles, Southern California area, we have the PAPA system, which is kind of the premier D-Star. You know, we cover down south of the border all the way up to Santa Barbara and beyond now. 13, 14 link repeaters that support analog and digital, and they're starting to roll DMR into it as well. And they have the Brandmeister stuff so that you can kind of crosstalk across all of those. And my experience with it's been so far that it's great, but you've kind of diluted the membership. So now on analog, where it used to be busy all the time, a lot of the guys are over on D-Star or on DMR. So there's not as much traffic there. And again, that's kind of recreational hobby stuff. As far as the ARES group's concerned, we're really staying away from that for a couple of reasons. One is, like you said, how do you get all the cats herded onto a single technology? Now, we do have a fusion repeater, but primarily, you know, we have it because it was inexpensive and they were rolling them out and we could get one, you know, cheap, and it'll support the analog as well. And then anybody's radio can play.
Do either of you guys drill with the digital stuff and test it out to see what what the possibilities could be?
No, at this point, we've got a few guys on DMR that we've run some tests amongst between a few of our hospitals to see how the communication link goes. But other than that, in our ARES group, we have not. We're doing demonstrations for our local amateur radio clubs. And we've got a few guys in our ARES group that have DMR and D-Star and Fusion, but at this point we're not training with it and not pushing it. It's analog, and that's kind of where everybody's at right now.
We're doing some of the other digital stuff, like we're doing getting into N-beams and FL Digi, and at least being able to pass documents that way. And we're starting a little bit of the ham broadnet and the Arden to be able to support some of the needs of the EOC, but that's not fully off the ground. But that's the digital stuff that we're looking at.
You mentioned a technology that I've heard the initials of, N-beams, but don't know very much about.
Yeah, so narrow band emergency messaging service. I think I got that right.
It helps a little.
Yeah. Only a little. It's great because, and you know, we've looked at like even stuff like the traffic nets, NTS traffic nets, you know, where you can pass a radiogram with a really good skilled operator, which is not me.
What is N-beams besides an acronym? Is it HF? So is it VHF?
It's, well, you know, you can use it either way. It's a tool set. It allows you to connect a laptop to a radio, again, UHF or VHF or HF as well, and transmit digital tones that you can convert into documents. And there's a whole suite of software. It's great. You can, the ICS 213 forms, they have a template for it, and you can fill out the form and it sends just the metadata, and someone on the other side that's ready to receive it will receive a completely filled out form, whether it's a 213 form or a radiogram or any of the other kind of standard documents that you have out there. And it gives you the ability to send a longer document like that, where you'd have to go through and do the phonetics to try, you know, move like a radiogram, where someone can do a radiogram 35, 40 seconds. That's really skilled, where you can, you know, boil it down to 5, 10, 12 seconds to send a completed form and have it received on the other side and validated and checksummed and, you know, 100% perfect, or at least what you're expecting it to be.
Okay. So, I'm trying to,
That'd be a great topic for a future show.
Yeah, it will be. I'm trying to look it up, on on the Google here, and I'm probably spelling things wrong, but I'm getting Battle of the Beams.
NBEMS.
Oh.
Without the A. There you go.
Let's see what it gets me.
There you go.
ARL's got something. What's the best place for me to look at this?
The ARL's got a good page on it. The W1HKJ, he's the author of it. But this is that little blurb right there is a really good kind of overview of what it does. So it's open source software, works on Mac, works on Windows, works on Linux. You don't need any like special hardware other than the laptop, although we like people to get signal links so that you're not hearing all the traffic back and forth.
Yeah.
It looks like you guys are using it down there too, Scott.
What we're doing is we are using RMS Express or WinLink Express now, and doing packet, which kind of does the same thing. You can have your forms built in. It's got an ICS 213. It's got a radiogram. I guess one of the guys that wrote RMS Express has also done a custom ICS 213 form to match what our shelter report form looks like, so that we can send that. We have that ability, but we did not use it during this last event. Just because of the fact that we didn't have all of our members ready and on the same platform to get it in place. But it sounds a lot like the NBeams.
Yeah, and some of our neighboring, so the ARES LAX Northeast, I'm part of the Northwest group, the Northeast is using WinLink some of those tools as well.
Yeah.
So same deal as the digital voice. These are digital data modes, VHF, HF. And once again, it's a cornucopia, an embarrassment of riches. Too many.
Well, you know, the benefit that of there, Gary, is the with the NBeams, all you need is a laptop and the power. The thing about the DMR or the D-Star is you need, you know, whether it's a microwave backbone or the real internet backbone to send those messages. The NBeams and the WingLink, it's just analog radio. So all you need to be able to do is power that laptop and have a skilled operator and be able to make the contact, you know, simplex with the recipient, and you can get that message through.
Okay. So the skilled operator, it sounds to me like the key here. And Scott, it sounds like you guys are working on building up skilled operators, but you don't have enough yet.
We're getting a lot closer. Our training officer for our ARES organization is phenomenal. He does a great job. And all of our meetings, all of our nets, he's really awesome in laying out training in a way that everybody can understand it. So one of the things that we're working on now is getting all of our members to understand the different digital modes that we can use on analog and how to use them and get proficient at them. So that's where we're at now. We're close. We're working at actually putting together standardized go kits for all of our shelters, so that every shelter will have the exact same kit, analog radio, power supply, a signal link, a computer. Everything will be standardized in a box. So when we do get deployed, they come pick up the box, they walk in, plug it in. Everything's the same. They've been trained on it and they're ready to go.
Oh, that's really awesome.
Yeah.
How you said you had about 15 people deploy. How many members does your ARES organization really have on the books?
Our ARES organization has 74 members, and out of that, we probably had about 35 of those that actually got on the radio and checked into the emergency net, and then 15 of those deployed. Some of our members just don't feel like they're ready to deploy, but they'll monitor from home, and they'll offer any assistance they can. They just don't feel like, and this is the same case amongst a lot of ARES organizations. They'll pick up a microphone and help out, but they don't know that they can go to a shelter and do what they need to do from there. But our membership is doing very, very good at that and much better. The average is usually about 10% of your membership will usually respond to a call out. In this case, we had over 20%. So we were very excited about that.
Those are great numbers.
Do you have the requirement for all of those ICS certificates before someone can be deployed or actually participate?
What our county requests is that we have the ICS 100, the 700.
1 and 7.
And then we have a background check that's done through our county. And that's just because we are going to shelters that are on school property. So we have a background check. And then we also have a security, an FBI security awareness that we do through our county sheriff department. So when we get those requirements done, that allows a member to be able to be deployed to one of our shelters here in Clay County.
David, but
of course, at that point.
I'm sorry, David, what do you guys require?
We ask that you have 1, 2, 7, and 8 as a minimum. And then, you know, other training goes along with that, you know, to hold a position, you need to have done some more, you know, to do the ARL, MCOM, like one course. But we don't force anybody, you know, we look to see that at least somebody on site understands and has those things. But it's hard to get volunteers to do that. But we're like several hundred people on the books. And as you said, you know, you get 10%, you know, the same 10% every time that actually show up.
Scott, we have heard a lot of what you're doing with your AEC hat. How about that PIO hat? That's the public information officer.
That's a whole other story. And the nice thing about being the PIO is that I'm not the guy that's in front of the camera. I can help facilitate that. We've got some great people in our membership. Again, our training officer has got some great relationships with some of our news media. So for Hurricane Matthew, we didn't have that much of a media presence for our help in this event. But the previous Hurricane Hermine that came across the top of Florida into Georgia, we had some great media coverage.
Radio operators are stepping in to help emergency workers during the storm. Now, at 10, we showed you how they provide services when other forms of communication fail. Michael Yoshida picks up our team coverage now in St. Johns County. And Michael, new at 11, you learned that these volunteers can provide more than just voice communication.
Tanika, these volunteer radio operators provide a variety of services. Now, that includes emergency communications for state and federal agencies when storms hit.
This repeater is now under Clay Ares Emergency Operations Protocol.
Joe Bassett is one of dozens of amateur radio operators standing by as Tropical Storm Hermine makes her way towards Florida.
When all else fails, we're ready to go.
Ready to answer the call if landlines, cell phones, or the internet fail.
Amateur radio, because it relies on airwaves and doesn't rely on infrastructure at all, can always step in when all else fails.
Amateur radio emergency service volunteers like Joe Bassett are scattered throughout counties in Northeast Florida. They're deployed at the request of government agencies.
Say a shelter needs to have more cots or more supplies delivered. We would pass that information via radio to the Emergency Operations Center.
The operators can be set up inside, or if they need, can be mobile. This is Bassett's Go Kit, which he can pack up in a matter of minutes. And if he's driving, Bassett can use this radio to talk and do much more.
In mine in particular, I can do worldwide communications or things that are just here locally. Even if the internet were to go down, I can still send emails using my radios from my truck.
So, if needed, Bassett and others can be a voice when the storm hits.
There are many times that we're there and ready to go that people don't realize and were never actually utilized, and we're thankful for that. But we pride ourselves in being ready to go.
Emergency radio operators in our local counties of Putnam, Clay, Nassau, Duval, and St. John's are also part of a larger regional group. That group actually met last week for training. Reporting live in St. John's County, Michael Yoshida, CBS 47 Action News Jax.
And we send out press releases. As soon as we're activated, I send out a press release. We send out a press release anytime that we're doing a public service event or anything in our community. We went out for Hurricane Hermine, and we got several calls from media. And we had a couple of really good TV interviews that were done that were used on our local news stations that got us a lot of interest in our ARES organization and what we do. And that has helped us out a lot. So it does allow me to talk to a lot of the media, maybe do an interview like this, maybe for our newspaper. But we do have a couple of our guys that have done TV interviews for us. And things have turned out very well. And we've had the last 2 to 3 months, we've had some really good publicity for ARES in general, not just for our Clay County organization, but for ARES in general.
I've seen in comments made on QRZ, you know, the font of all knowledge, QRZ.com, the comments that appear after a program, the ones that we did. You get some guys that are really, really vociferous on the idea that ham radio is no longer useful for emergency communications. And get upset that most of our publicity is in the emergency communications realm and not other stuff. Does that bother either of you guys?
You know, it does. I got into amateur radio for emergency communications.
You're one of those.
I am. I'm one of those. I got in because I saw how it could help the community, and I saw how it was working to help the community. And so when somebody tells me that ham radio is non-existent or doesn't provide any help, now I point them back to Hurricane Matthew and say, well, if it doesn't help, then why does our county call on us to offer communications? Why do they use us? And amateur radio is still very alive. You know, when I first got in, I always thought, well, this was my grandfather's hobby. But now that I'm in it, I see how it can help and how we do help, not just in an emergency, but, in day-to-day public service. We support, more than just our emergency operations center. We've got, we just did the MS-150, bike ride that usually goes from, Sawgrass, along the coast all the way down to Daytona, but due to the storm and the damage that was caused, they kept it a little bit more local, and we did support for that. We do work with Florida Striders a lot for their runs in our local area, and we support them. So I don't see how they don't think that ham radio is an emergency communications tool, or how it's not usable anymore, because it's definitely used here in Northeast Florida.
Yeah, and I'm one of those too, Gary. I got an amateur radio because of that too. In fact, you know, 6 years ago, I've been licensed about 6 years. I took a cert class through the elementary school where I was a parent and a board member. And when the cert class was over, we did a couple drills and a couple hams showed up. And it was something I wanted to do 25, 30 years ago, but couldn't learn the code or didn't want to take the time to learn the code. And when we figured out, didn't need it anymore. You know, I was in the next class and I was licensed and got involved pretty much right away.
All right. Well, this is the EmComm Extra thing that we're trying to gin up in ham radio now. So it sounds to me like there's going to be plenty to talk about as we do this on a regular basis.
You know, yeah. I would hope that a show like this would do a lot to pique the interest of people into emergency communications, not just in Florida but across the United States, because it's definitely something that's needed all the way across the board. People think that the internet, that the 800 to 900 megahertz radios and their towers, that they're just going to be there all the time. We've had situations in Northeast Florida where that system has gone down, and our police and fire departments have been on limited communications because their towers have not been accessible for some reason or another. So, I mean, amateur radio is always there. And like they said, when all else fails, ham radio, there's nothing else to take over for it.
All right. Well, our 10-minute conversation has now hit about 30 minutes. Yeah, you've got family and folks visiting you need to go pay attention to, I guess.
Although
you seem to be enjoying this.
So. Well, I hope that they do. They'll be here shortly. And they're actually the ones that are coming over. They actually participated in Hurricane Matthew also at one of our shelters. They were there the whole time. So I told them that I'd be doing this.
Why aren't they sitting behind you talking to me?
Well, if they would have been here and we had waited and done this later, they probably would have been. Yep. But, you know, one of them's a little camera shy, but that would have been okay. You know, I will add this, just to say kudos to our people in Clay County. The 15 members that did help out in Hurricane Matthew donated 531 hours of time to our county and to the members and those who live in our county. To help with Hurricane Matthew. So, you know, my deepest thanks to all those people in Clay County that are part of the Clay County ARES group that offered their time. It was incredible. And when going back over all the paperwork for it and seeing everything that was done, when the hours were totaled up and that number was 531 hours, I was pretty shocked.
Yeah, a lot of value there. David, you got anything last minute to add before we let Scott go?
No, I just think the story's great and it's excellent. 500 hours is amazing, and you get the people out there and support. And I only hope here in Los Angeles that when we need it, we get those kind of numbers and everything works out as well as it did for you guys.
All right. So thank you very much for joining us here on Ham Radio Now. We are going to move on for a few more stories, and we'll be in touch.
All right. Thank you very much. You guys have a great
day. Great talking to you, Scott.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Scott, for telling us what went on down just south of Jacksonville. David, are you frozen? No, you're good.
I am.
Yeah.
I'm not.
It comes and goes.
Yeah.
Let's move up the coast just a little bit and get into South Carolina, where they got hit just a little bit harder with this hurricane. And we'll bring on to the show, this is Linda Selleck, KJ4EVV. You are the emergency coordinator for Berkeley County, South Carolina. And that is just outside of Charleston. I'm going to see if I can bring up your location on Google Map. So the outline that we're looking at here is Berkeley County, and it may be a little difficult for folks to see, but the red outline of the county just misses the coast. You don't get really any coast.
Except for the tidal areas of Daniel Island at the very most southern edge of the area.
Yeah,
in fact, the National Weather Service had to do a tidal Berkeley versus inland Berkeley for weather.
Yep. So that's a little bit of you right next to the city of Charleston. And I believe that Charleston was landfall for the hurricane, one of the only landfall area.
Actually, it was slightly north up in McClellanville, if memory serves, just slightly up the coast from there.
Okay, so there's McClellanville. But, I mean, it was big. So, if it was technically that's where the eye crossed, you all got hit in there pretty big. Would be my guess.
It could have been a lot worse, though.
How bad was it?
Well, there was quite a bit of power loss in the northern portion of our county. We had power losses throughout the tri-county area of Charleston, Dorchester, and Berkeley. The areas further north and over to the western portion of the counties, those areas... they were out of power for a few days, actually. And then the eastern side of the county actually had some flooding along the Santee. And we actually lost some roads and various other things that was very eerily similar to our rain event that we had had last year.
Just a rain event?
Last year, Hurricane Jacqueline, I believe it was, had made a very close brush, and the way that the fronts were oriented, it caused for a great deal of rain, like 10, 12 inches, possibly more. I can't remember the exact number, but it caused all our rivers to overflow, basically, especially the ones that weren't controlled by dams. And there was a great deal of inland flooding further inland to the state. In the Midlands, Columbia lost actual dams in the process.
What category was Matthew when it got to you? Was it a category one at that point?
It was a one-ish, two-ish at that point. I'm not exactly sure what it was when it made landfall. I'd have to actually look that up. All I know is it was pretty windy when I had to run outside a couple of times to get some things.
Linda, what did the deployment for the ARES group look like for this particular storm? How many people? What'd you guys do?
We had approximately 13 or 14 individuals that were able to come out. Unfortunately, the mass evacuation had cleared out quite a few of our hams.
Yeah.
Somebody actually did an FCC database call recently, and there's 392 hams in Berkeley County, and we had 11 of them show up, one from another county crossover, and two from Kershaw area came in after I put out a statewide request for hams.
Yeah, let me get a little bit of detail on that, because your area was mandatory evacuation. How far did that extend?
It was everything except Zone H for us, which is the northernmost portion of the county, all of Charleston, most of Dorchester from Somerville east, and right about where that red line ends, where it's following that river, just about everything south of that was under evacuation. And we don't have the differential between mandatory and voluntary evacuations. It's just evacuations in general in South Carolina.
So some of the hams stayed, but most of them went.
Yes. There were quite a few people that were non-hams that stayed too, but yep. Teach their own.
This Interstate 26 that heads on up toward Columbia, was reversed. All four lanes were pointed up toward Columbia, and that has been a fairly rare thing. It's just something that states are experimenting with now as coastal states, with turning those highways around to get people out of town. How did that work? Well, you didn't go.
I wasn't on it. The evacuations, when the word came down on Tuesday afternoon, I was leaving work, and we went out, and everybody was at the gas stations, and the eye was starting to back up until they reversed it. The following day, they announced that they were going to reverse them at 3 o'clock on Wednesday, and it was just wall-to-wall traffic getting out. I actually saw some video off a DOT camera. It looked eerie, seeing all six lanes, and at a certain point it becomes four lanes, but down in the Charleston proper area, it's actually six lanes all going the same direction, and nobody could get off unless it was at specific stops that they'd set up to let people offer gas and so forth.
So when they evacuated, what made you stay, or how did you decide to stay?
She's the EC.
I don't get it. So I know if they evacuate my neighborhood, if the sheriffs come and knock on the door and say evacuate, when I tell them they're an EC, they're like, that's nice, and please evacuate.
Yeah.
I'm actually not in an evacuation zone. When I picked my house, I deliberately picked it into the last area that would be evacuated. I live actually up in Monk's Corner, even though my license is tied to Goose Creek. I have a PO box in the next municipality. It works for me. But the area I live in and the area where the EOC is actually inland somewhat. It's actually in Monk's Corner. So I actually was going to Monk's Corner, and they weren't kicking us out anyway. They weren't doing full door-to-door. There's just too many people in Charleston area to do that. If they were doing any of that, they were doing it down in Charleston County, maybe on the coast, but they weren't doing it inland. They were just saying, you need to leave. And at one point, all fire, EMS, police, they were actually, I hate to say the word grounded, but they weren't rolling because the winds were kicking too high for them to be safe out there.
Sure.
Yeah. Well, I guess when we talk about what hams do, I'm sure there was some Skywarn activity going on, and maybe folks checking into the Hurricane Watch net as the hurricane was coming in. But most of our activity is going to happen afterwards, I think.
Before, during, and after, in our case, the policy for our county is that when the EOC becomes OPCON 3, we are required to activate, and we put at least one ham at every shelter, or every shelter that we have ham, until we run out of hams, which we did, unfortunately, and I had to request from state and hire to get additional hams, and we had a couple come in from Kershaw that were able to get in just as the storm was starting to hit, and I'm grateful for those two that came out. I unfortunately don't have their call signs handy. Otherwise, I would give them proper kudos. But we had hams working 24-hour shifts at some of the shelters, unfortunately, just because of sheer lack of manpower. Thankfully, they were all willing.
So your deployment began with hams heading to the shelters that people were going to go to before the hurricane arrived. So you wanted to have those all ready to go.
The shelters opened the same day that the evacuation started. That was the how it was designed and set up this particular go-round. Once the evacuations kicked in it on Wednesday, the shelters opened at 3 o'clock that afternoon, and just not long after, over the next few days, more and more shelters opened up. I think at the height of it, we had six or seven shelters open, and at least four or five of them were manned by hams. We had one or two that we could not man just because sheer lack of manpower.
What was the communications situation in terms of infrastructure holding up or failing as the entire situation occurred over several days, so the hurricane arriving and then the flooding that occurred afterwards?
For the most part, we had most of the infrastructure stay up, although power was lost. So at that point, we started having dropouts over time as the cell phone networks failed. Generators only have so much gas in them, obviously.
Yeah.
And of course, once the power was down, that was a lost cause. But most of the schools around here are designed in a way that cell phone signals don't get out easily anyway. So that's why the hams are as required as we are.
So your ham activity actually proved useful, essential as the conduit for communication from those shelters. Was there anything besides shelters? Or was it were shelters your primary mission?
That's our primary mission. We also manned one EOC in a municipality just slightly south of where we were that was actually hosting the special needs shelter was not far from where that municipality center was, and they had their own secondary EOC, and I had a ham in there as well for the duration of the event. In fact, I had to install an antenna on that one, and it was rather a creative install.
Yeah. Give me a little bit of your background. A female EC is a, I try not to make too big a deal about women in ham radio, but you're relatively rare, and you know, there's some deal to be made, I guess. How did you get into doing this?
I grew up in Eastern North Carolina, and having watched my parents, my father's a former volunteer firefighter, and they're both prior EMTs involved with Red Cross at one point in their lives. Floyd came through my hometown when I was a freshman in college. I don't make bones about my age. I'm 35. I was 18 and like 2 weeks when Floyd came through, and I saw all of what was going on there. And I decided that when I was old enough and stable enough, I wanted to be able to help. Started looking into ways to do that, but realized very quickly that I wasn't cut out to do more of the one-on-one interaction like my mom had done. So I started looking for more technological routes because I'm an analyst in real life. So I wanted to be a weather spotter, and that led me to realize that most weather spotters were amateur radio operators. So I went to get a ham license, got licensed in 2008, and I became the EC for Berkeley last year, and just before the rain event, actually, in 2015. And my first day on the job was unfortunately mucking out my radio room because we had just had so much rain that it had unfortunately gone under the walls of our EOC and was actually on the floor in our EOC, and it actually messed up a few boxes in my radio room.
So you got the cleanup detail right away. Yay.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. Do the guys get along with you pretty well? Are we chauvinist or are we enlightened today?
They're good people, most of them. And the ones that aren't tend to stay away. So
I sort of get the impression you can handle yourself.
I try.
So how big is your group? How big is the ARES group that you work with?
It's actually rather small right now. We've had some attrition, unfortunately, just due to inactivity. As my Elmer says, we need a good disaster, unfortunately, in order to swell the ranks. But we're working on that.
Well, you just had one.
Matthew has actually opened up some eyes, and we actually just had a bit of a recruitment at an expo yesterday, matter of fact, and I'm hoping to put together a class and get a bunch of hams licensed and get more into the ranks of ARES because they're part of the Interfaith Disaster Council, and I'm hoping that will produce quite a few hams that will be into the emergency service.
Yeah, David and I, in our previous interview, Scott, have been talking a little bit about the idea of people getting into ham radio from the EmComm aspect, and it sounds like you're another one in that that category. That's what got you in. Is that exclusively your ham radio activity, or have you broadened out know, do you rag chew, work DX contests?
I do enjoy a contest when I can, but I haven't actually installed my rig at my house yet. I've been strictly mobile and HT since I moved a few years ago. I haven't actually finished, fleshed out the design and gone through the architectural review board with my HOA, who, believe it or not, are actually quite understanding. I've actually got a good HOA. I'm limited to a three foot diameter in a 10, but I can do a lot in 3 feet.
Yeah.
All right. I'd like to know the communications infrastructure that you guys have available down there. Were you all VHF, UHF? Did any HF come into play?
We had mostly VHF communications. We have a primary repeater that the 146610 that lives at our more or less central to the county. And then we have a secondary one that is unfortunately offline at the moment. It's undergoing repairs. But usually we have a secondary backup repeater on a separate frequency that if the first one ever falls over, so to speak, we have that backup. In the greater area, there's a linked network. We are not part of the link, though. There's some back history to that that I won't get into, but it's fairly lengthy. But we do have the HF in the radio room, and I did actually make contact out on HF a few times and actually asked for a few extra hams that way. And obviously, we did have some. We also had some weird skip up into Greenville Spartanburg on our repeater for some reason, which was rather entertaining.
Yeah, that actually does tend to happen on hurricanes. We get band openings along hurricane fronts. South Carolina has a pretty extensive network system, the SC Hearts, on FM. They had one on D-Star, and now I think I see more DMR. Do you guys participate in the Hearts?
No, not so much. We're aware of it. There is obviously, we actually listen off and on to one of their frequencies. Made a couple of contacts that direction just to check on some things, but for the most part, not so much.
Okay, so it sounds like the things you were doing in your county were fairly self-contained within the county. Now, you're right next to Charleston, but not a lot of interaction?
Oh, yes, there's plenty of interaction. We all share people. In fact, Dorchester, Charleston, and Berkeley all kind of collaborate quite a bit. The ECs are, we all communicate with one another. It's not a, you know, big deal for us to do things. I'm actually hoping for a joint meeting for our next ARES meeting, in fact, just because ours would fall on Thanksgiving. But, yeah, I mean, don't get us wrong. We'll check into the Hearts network sometimes, but some of the repeaters, I just can't reach any of the linked repeaters from my house with my car. So that's why I'm personally not overly active.
David, what in your area, what kind of cooperation is there between the various counties and sections?
We have, so inside of, you know, the LAX section, there are four different kind of subsections, and we do a lot of communications with them, do drills with them. Usually we do, you know, countywide, so that brings all of those groups together. But then there are other, you know, there's a group that works with Sheriff's Department, there's a group that works with the Fire Department, and we do some, there are some interoperability nets, and I check on those pretty frequently, once a week, just to make sure we have those conversations going. We drill maybe once a year with those other groups, just so that, you know, we have the communications going. And we have a couple of members or a number of members that, you know, kind of fall across the several different, you know, we wear several badges. My primary role, my primary mission is always ARES. I'll always show up to ARES before I'll do anything else or support anything else. And there are a number of people in the organization who will say, okay, that's fine, but I'm going to the ACS works with the Fire Department, or I'm going to DCS, I work with the Sheriff's Department. But we do try to work together as much as we can.
And a lot of my hams are like that. They're dual hatters.
Yeah.
In fact, my AEC and I, and about half the hams and ARES are all CERT. I mean, Community Emergency Response Team. Yep. So, but most of us will put ARES first, obviously.
Yeah, there's a show in that CERT thing. I'm aware of its existence. I don't know a whole lot about it. It happens around here too. And it sounds like there's a great tie-in with ham radio, but we'll do a show about CERT sometime coming up. Mm-hmm. Linda, you got some pictures that you sent along that look pretty interesting. Can you guide me through some of these?
Yeah, if you pull them up so I can know which ones I'm looking at.
Okay. You should be seeing something coming down the line at you.
Yeah, that one is...
David was making fun of you for this.
Oh, yes. This is an install. I actually took rope up to the roof of the this is the roof of that municipality I mentioned, their EOC. I went up there pretty much blind, not knowing what was up there, with the antenna, the feed line, and rope. And turned out the rope wasn't working. Thankfully, the guy that was with me had some zip ties tucked into his pocket, and we used those because I just couldn't find the rope that would hold it in a way that the wind wouldn't take it out.
So it looks like a dual band J-pole.
It is. It's an arrow. It's the county bought a number of them. They were originally going to all be installed on schools permanently. And yeah, there's another view of it. There's a whole bunch of other stuff on that pole as well. So I just happened to just go with this little offshoot section and run the wire through the metal so that the antenna wouldn't take the strain if the wind got hold of the feed line real bad.
That's great. Those work well for you, those arrows?
Yeah, they did, actually. We never lost contact with that particular municipality. It's quite good.
That's definitely ham resiliency right there.
What do we got here?
Oh, that one is my assistant emergency coordinator, KB7QVG. That is his sacrificial antenna. It was guy-wired down in the parking lot of the special needs shelter where he was stationed. And he was originally going to be in a different location, ended up at special needs, but I think it's a quad band box antenna, I believe. But if it goes away with the wind, it's not a big loss. And he had a backup antenna that he would put up afterwards.
So you say a sacrificial antenna. So let's see what else we got here. Another J-pole. This one more permanent, looks like.
Yeah, that one is actually a permanent, one of the examples of the permanent ones that was at a shelter that I had them check on to make sure it was still there before they used the feed line. And obviously it was validated as being there, and they sent me the picture. But this is actually one of the permanent installs from one of the shelters. Okay. Nothing special about it. It's just, it was installed in 2009, I think, long before I became EC.
Now it looks like we're inside somewhere. Yeah, I think there's some lag in the Skype picture coming back to you.
That degraded. I'm sorry.
We're looking at a radio room. Seeing some radios hanging from shelves.
Yeah, this is the heart of W4BRK, if to coin a phrase there. On the left-hand side is our HF rig. That's a FT-857. And on the right, that is a FT-8800, both of which are good, solid little radios. I love them both. Obviously, our VHF-UHF gets a whole lot of use because that is just how we operate with the 6.1 and the 1.5 and various other repeaters in the area. On the other channel, the secondary channel with the 8800, we were checking in on other frequencies just to maintain contact with other counties.
And how much time did you end up having your EOC staffed?
From Wednesday afternoon until Monday midday.
Wow,
that's a long time.
We racked up about 650 hours across everybody because I had to do this reporting. Mm-hmm. The guy that was doing net control and I both racked up 109 hours.
Did you go all night?
Somebody was sleeping in the radio room at all times if it was a, you know, sleep cycle.
Yeah. So you're saying most of your communications was with the shelters. Did any, serious stuff go down?
Oh, well, we had a lady go into labor at one shelter and unfortunately she did so, when at the point where ambulances weren't rolling. So she was able to wait it out and she got, I presume she got transported after they were able to roll safely again. But as far as we know, she didn't deliver in the shelter, which was a good thing.
I'm not much of an expert on this. I don't believe that there's any way one can say, just wait a minute, I'm not ready yet.
We got lucky.
Yeah.
Thankfully, it was just us passing the communication, not actually having to do anything about it. But EMS was already on site. Yeah. So if the worst had happened and there had been an addition to the shelter population,
We've added a count of one to the shelter. They did not come in from outside. They appeared here spontaneously.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, we were actually making jokes about that with the Red Cross rep. The shelter population did not go up by one yet.
Do you guys know about how many people hit the shelters? How many people you supported?
I overheard the number of about six. Across the Tri-County, I think it was, or possibly the east side, I think it was like 6,300 or something like that. I'm not entirely certain, but within our area, I think it maxed out at about a 1,500 or so across all the shelters we had.
That's great.
All right. I've got that little piece of video that you put in here. Let me bring up the sound and make that roll.
Oh, this is one of the ones where I had to run outside, unfortunately, at the very beginning of the rain. I actually can't see her here, but that's outside of our ESC.
Okay. Yeah, it looked exciting.
Just a little bit of wind and rain outside the ESC. The next video This one was taken after the eye pass. This is the backside of the storm, which had a lot less rain, but a lot more wind. In fact, I had to run out because there was a tree endangering my vehicle at that point.
You can see that antenna.
Yeah, the antennas are bending up there on the tower.
Oh.
Yeah, and that one in the center that's bending the most, that was our 2-meter antenna. Yep. The one we used for UHF, VHF. And that longer wire, that's actually our HF antenna. And it was bebopping around too.
Okay. Got something else strapped to a post.
Oh, yes. This was at one of the school shelters. I started installing this one as the rains were starting to sprinkle slightly. I was standing on a ladder with the assistant principal being my safety person at the bottom, and the ham that was stationed there passing me things as we're tying this thing up. Used a roll of tape to get it over the very top. And, yes, that is tied down and duct taped and padded, so that it wouldn't beat the aluminum against the pole during the wind.
Yeah. Oh, and that's upside down. So your signal was going upside down.
Still have vertical orientation. Upside down doesn't seem to matter. We actually tested it and we were like, wow, it still works. You know, we were actually kind of amazed by how well these little suckers behaved.
So what did you learn from this this event that you know, anything that like didn't work and you've got a hot wash planned for improving things next time?
Obviously our biggest one was build up the ham radio population enough to where we don't have to worry about people not being able to come out. A lot of our most active members are actually tied up with, you know, Red Cross or fire station or medical or various other things. And then we had, of course, the attrition that comes with aging, unfortunately. The prior EC had been district and had to retire from district due to his health. So we were down a district guy, and it just, a lot of the older members were losing them. Not a fun thing to, we actually just lost a major state guy just last week, matter of fact, John Crockett. He had died recently. He was actually instrumental in helping to set up some of the linked network, that statewide SC Hearts that you mentioned earlier.
Yeah.
Yeah, when I joined in our ARES group, I was 45 or so, and, you know, brought the average age of the room down by a lot of years.
Yeah, so you've done that even more, Linda.
And yeah, and it's, yeah, you know, and when Gary asked you about, you know, is it a challenge for the, a lot of the members to listen to you as a female, I'd be more concerned about them. Is it from an age perspective, right? Cause it was a challenge for me when I first started too. Oh, that young whippersnapper.
Honestly, I have no issues with deferring to their knowledge, huh? And drawing on that knowledge as needed. I recognize fully that they, that there are many, many hams that have been at this longer, and my job is to, as EC, is to use that knowledge effectively and use that knowledge, ask them for what they know, ask them for options, you know. And I have, one of the reasons I'm the EC is that I can coordinate well. And on the plus side, even though I'm not as technically strong as some, either, even though I'm not really bad off, my assistant EC is practically MacGyver. And
good guy to have.
Yeah, very much so. And we have a few other people that are just amazingly strong technically and can go out to a shelter and make it work no matter what. And me being the EC, it allows them to go out and do that while I'm dealing with the coordination and the dealing with the government officials and so forth.
Yeah, that's the skill, is the communication and being able to deal with people and understand where to defer and where to step up and do your job as an EC. That's same thing for me, right? The technical skills are important, but it's the people and the coordination and all the logistics and understanding those things.
I've seen this sort of thing in the business world where the best engineer in the group gets promoted to be the manager. Well, his qualifications for being manager were not being a great engineer.
Yeah.
And so now you've eliminated a great engineer and you've installed a not so good manager. So it sounds like there's a lesson in the ARES groups that your best ARES guy, maybe not the best EC. Good manager is the best EC.
And that's kind of probably why I was appointed in such a position. And I'm honored regardless, and I'm trying to do my best by the county. Whether or not I succeed is up for debate.
Well, we'll see.
Get back to me in a few decades.
Yeah. If you're still around in a few decades, you've clearly succeeded. If you're still around 5 years, you've succeeded very well. Does your ARES group require ICS certification for membership or deployment?
Yes. All our ARES members are required to take 100, 200, 700, and 800 of the ICS coursework within about a year of joining. Every now and then we'll actually have a training session. We'll review some of the material to make sure that everyone's got it and so forth. But yeah, that's part of the requirements we have in Berkeley County to be ARES, as well as the basic background check, because we're co-located with the sheriff's office.
Has that been difficult in terms of, is that an impediment to recruitment, or do people just kind of say, yeah, that's what you do now?
Not so much. Most people tend to understand the needs of the area, and if they don't like it, so be it. That's not been an issue for us. Nobody's balked at that. I think at this point, most in the society is starting to become par for the course.
Yeah. So the big deal right now is just finding more hams.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm aiming for to try and get as many as I can, you know, not just technically able. Although I'd love to have the hands that are technically able. I also like, I don't mind growing the new ones. And if I have my way, my 7-year-old, when she's of age to join ARES, will be right there with me. But we don't let them be part of full ARES, like in the EOC and stuff, till they're 18.
Yeah. David, your big connection to kids is the scouts. You're a scout leader.
Yeah.
I imagine you recommend that.
We try real hard. So I'm still trying to get my three kids to get their tickets, and they come along and do a lot of volunteer stuff, but they still haven't sat down to study. And in scouting, When I joined the troop, I was already ham, and they were using FRS. And I like to say FRS is kind of the gateway drug to amateur radio. We went out a number of outings. Kind of the first time I showed up and really participated was a backpacking trip where we did 15, 16 miles in a weekend. And, you know, the trail of scouts spread out so much that I was listening to their FRS traffic. And at some point it became an emergency because they couldn't hear each other. And so I jumped in with my commercial radio to help support that. Right. So I tried to be all legal and have a GMRS license. And so that's okay. But since then, have gotten, I don't know, almost a dozen of the adults to go and take the course that I did that the sheriff's department offers. And, you know, it's like a one day with some follow-ons and get their tickets. And a number of scouts as well have gotten their tickets. And, you know, at some point I offered anybody that went and got their ticket, I'd buy them a radio and, you know, the brand name that comes from China that I would be getting them.
That's getting easier these days.
Yeah. Yeah. And I have done that twice. And continue to try to get them to do it. And some go and do it and some don't. And, so I expose them and they see it and they think it's fun and love Jamboree on the Air every year because they get to, you know, play radio with or without the license.
Yeah. So Linda, I don't know, maybe boy and girl scouts there.
It's a future thing. Unfortunately, our JOTA, most of our JOTA locations got pretty well trash during the storm.
Yeah, I bet. Because
two of the three major ones are, there's one called Camp Oscar, and it's actually an individual's private property, but he's been long associated with Boy Scouts, and his area was basically turned into a swamp, unfortunately. It was messed up, trees down.
Go ahead.
I think that was on Jones Island. And then I can't, Camp Onanwa got, I think they lost buildings due to trees falling on them. And I understand the road access to Camp Moultrie actually was washed out. So the Boy Scouts are kind of in a world of hurt right now for JOTA.
That second camp you talked about, Onawaka, is that it? There was a national call out to the Boy Scouts of America that went through, you know, our kind of our email blast list for volunteers with chainsaws and gloves and whatever support they could come to provide to that camp because they had so many trees down. And I don't know what kind of response they got to that, but I did see a couple of emails after the storm had come through for that kind of help for that unit, that particular camp.
One of the nearby beaches to that location actually had 4 feet of sand in the road behind the houses, that first line of houses. You got beach, houses, road. Yeah. The road was up to the mailboxes in sand.
Oh, amazing.
The at least here in North Carolina, and I think probably around you too, Linda, the hurricane recovery is still going on.
Yes. Yeah. And my hometown is actually up in North Carolina as well, and they're still undergoing recovery as well.
Yeah, I think most of the flooding has finally receded, although just barely. But that's left a lot of damage. And I don't know how much of a communications emergency it is left. I get the impression that for the most part, once again, the major communications infrastructure, the cell phone systems, the public safety systems held together. We weren't called on to fill in any big gaps.
I had to fill in one. We had a shelter that, the way it was structured, it was completely, the 800 megahertz system was actually non-functional. And I had to actually had to pull a ham out of one shelter and send him across the county in the middle of the storm to get him to a shelter that had absolutely no comms, even with the police and EMS up there. And he had to go along down the middle of the road with his car riding over the yellow line, but he was able to make it. And he got there and we got comms back with them, which was good.
Did he help out with the EMS and public safety as well, since their stuff wasn't working?
Eventually, it turned out about the same time he got there, they actually got a repeater on wheels out there. So that helped with that as well. But he was still instrumental in getting, you know, communications back with the shelter people as well. So it was coming from two fronts. So they alleviated that issue altogether on both fronts with that. but they hadn't got that cow.
Yeah, you don't wait for that to happen. You step in as quick as you can.
Yep. It just happened that we were lucky enough that we were able to get something there, because that area, they lost power not long after that. We had about three or four, we had at least four shelters have to go on generator power. And unfortunately, they lost power during the storm. And the generators obviously can't go on during the storm because the way that they're designed, where you kneel, somebody has to obviously go and shut off the mains and turn it over. And I don't know what the situation was, but obviously they weren't going to send somebody out in the middle of the storm to do this.
Yeah. Yeah. During the storm, everybody pretty much hunkers down. A friend of mine, local ham, just down the road, works for one of the big phone companies, and he ended up just after the storm all around South Carolina, basically gassing up generators for cell phone systems. So that was his job, and he saw a lot of the devastation and kind of reported back on the DMR system. Your DMR system never got turned over to its total emergency function, so that we were still able to talk to a few of those guys as they were driving around, reporting on everything that they were seeing. David, you've got anything else you want to toss in?
So, one of the questions we didn't ask is, most of your traffic voice, or are you doing any electronic messaging, or?
We haven't got everybody set up with that yet. So almost everything we've been doing has been voice so far, although we have ideas on how to improve some of that and maybe even do some digital mode with that. But it's, push comes to shove, you end up just sending somebody out with a rig and doing voice.
Lowest common denominator. That's kind of what we do here too. We're trying to roll out more of that. And that's what Scott said as well. So kind of par for the course.
Hey, Linda, anything else that you have thought of that you've been saying, I wish they'd ask me?
No, I think we're good. We had some fun. We learned some lessons. We also learned some fun with the miscommunications. Our media and our shelter list somehow got miscommunicated, and so here we are standing in a meeting, and I'm looking at this national news feed weather for all, and saying, this shelter, this shelter, and this shelter. And I'm going, there's not shelters. I don't have hams there. So do I need to fix that? And they're like, those are not right. You know.
But people, I think you're telling us people ended up there because they were directed there by those broadcasts.
Yeah. We actually had to open up one of our shelters, but just because there were that many people there. I'm not sure how that worked out politically or with the shelter managers or all that. It just, there was some miscues there because I think somebody got a bad shelter list, which was not good.
Were you able to get a ham there?
Yeah, we did, actually.
And did that ham provide communications back to say, well, here's what's going on, and help clear up some confusion? Or did they get to create more confusion?
No, actually, they got there, and Red Cross got there and actually got the shelter spun up. And in some cases, it was a case where that shelter was not set to be opened yet. And unfortunately, there were people basically waiting outside before it was actually due to be opened by the Red Cross personnel. So it was kind of a, okay, yikes. But we relayed the information back, and Red Cross and the various entities outside of the radio room handled most of that. So thankfully I wasn't involved in any of that other than just relaying that communications, and I was happy to let them have that particular ball of wax.
You get to be the telephone operator. It's not my fault. Don't shoot the operator.
Yeah, pretty much.
I have thought of a question that David, we haven't talked about at all in any of the EmComm Extra stuff that we've done so far. And that is, there has been some controversy over the role of a ham at a shelter or in other areas where we've been asked to do things that are not necessarily communications. They could be sweeping the floor, or they could be something more glamorous, but they're not communications. How do you guys feel about that?
Officially, our role is communications, and it doesn't matter if it is fax machines, ham radio, cell phone, manning the landline, We haven't been asked to do smoke signals yet, but it, ultimately, if it's communications, we don't mind. Now, if we're within range of, you know, a radio and we're able to respond properly and they ask us to, you know, maybe help out with something, or they see the need and they're just sitting idle waiting for a shelter check or something, as long as it doesn't interfere with the ARES duties, I don't have a problem with it personally, so long as the ARES duties are always first priority. You know, having an idle set of hands sitting there, perfectly good hands, and, you know, if they're willing, able, want to, so long as the ARES is not compromised in any way, I have no issues with it.
And it sounds like it's something that the individual ham on location is going to sort of make that call for themselves.
Yes, and if there is an interference at some point where it is actively interfering with their ability to communicate, then yes, it has to come to an end.
Yeah.
But we'll deal with that on a case-by-case basis.
David?
Yeah, we our mission's communications. And I know there are other groups in our area that do things like traffic control. And for the ARES group, that's not our mission. That's not our role. We're there to communicate. And just like Linda said, it doesn't matter if it's a cell phone or a fax machine or a landline or our radio or their radio or something else. That's the job, and that's the job that we ask the volunteers to do. And we try not to go outside of that job. And that, you know, that's the party line, and I'll stick with that.
Yeah, we tell them, you know, your communications duties are, this is why you're there. And we haven't actually had an issue with it, so it's never really come to where we've had to get, you know, hard on that particular line, just because it's never come up. Nobody's been that moronic yet.
Yeah, you know, we work a lot in the hospitals, with the hospitals, and, you know, it's very clear. We're not moving gurneys. We're not feeding patients. We're not moving people. We're not helping out. The job is communications. And, you know, we haven't had, luckily, in the last 5 years as I've been really involved, a big enough disaster where they've asked us to do something else. So far, not a big issue. But, yeah, that's the message, is we're communicators and we'll communicate for you.
Yeah, we haven't had that issue, and there's no actual hospitals beyond emergency rooms in Berkeley County at this point in time, although they're supposedly trying to fix that. So that issue has not come up. I do understand that they're at the hospitals in another county that actually do have proper hospitals. There's actually designated communicators that are on staff, but I believe they're also designated as communicators. Beyond that, I don't know.
Okay. I think that's a subject that will come up again and again and again. It's going to be heard from. Thank you very much, Linda. Appreciate the service that you have provided to your county in ARES and for stepping up. We're glad there's people around like you that have that interest and goal in their ham radio activity.
We all try. It's with various levels of success.
Yeah.
Well, it was great to meet you, Linda.
Nice to meet you as well. Thank you, gentlemen.
Wow. Two awesome conversations with the people right in the thick of things.
Yeah, I'm glad we were able to get somebody who was on the ground for this last event here, and that was good.
Yeah. So we had Scott Roberts, KK4ECR, who's the AEC PIO, Clay County ARES, just outside of Jacksonville, Florida, and Linda Selleck, KJ4EVV, who's the EC for Berkeley County, South Carolina, and they're just outside of Charleston. I contacted a lot of people. I don't think I contacted too many folks at the EC level. So they got forwarded to me for communication. I talked to section emergency, sent email to SECs and to, the district ECs. And then finally I reached to the PIOs. The action that I got was from the PIOs. Those people understand media.
Yep. That's their job.
Their job to make the media stuff work. So.
Yeah.
Thank you, PIOs. My fellow PIOs. Any last lingering thoughts that you've got on what we did?
You know, I just think it's great. I think this format, this model is great. It's great to see both the way Linda and Scott, you know, similar missions in different areas, and it all worked well. And, you know, everybody's got their little challenges, but, you know, they all stepped up and served, and lots of good volunteer hours, you know, between the two of them, over 1,000 hours of volunteer time to respond to the community in need. And that's what EmComm's all about.
Yeah. So as far as this show goes, the EmComm Extra version of Ham Radio Now, I'm sure we're going to catch more and more attention from the EmComm-related yep. hams. And to those hams, those hams who disparage EmComm participation or say that the guys who get in just because they're interested in EmComm, that they're not real hams.
That was good there, Gary.
Yeah, I like doing that.
There's definitely a role for us. There's yeah. definitely a role.
Yeah, and if that's what you enjoy in ham radio, and if that's all you enjoy in ham radio, well, more power to you. Just keep it up. If you feel like branching out and doing more as your interest and time and finances and stuff allow, then there's plenty more for you to do. And like I said, in the Tapper conference, there were a fair number of folks that were deep in the technology, but they were aiming their advanced technology at EmComm. So, we'll dip into that pool a little bit too.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing that content.
Yeah,
and that might spur some future shows here as well.
Because I don't know if I'm concerned that we are relying so much on the least common denominator of FM repeaters and simplex and not taking advantage. I mean, everyone said they wanted to get more digital in there, not necessarily digital voice, but data modes that would allow them to send information from shelters yeah. or wherever they need to more efficiently than voice. Alpha, Bravo, Charlie.
Absolutely. So, we talked about, with Scott, we talked about NBeams, and maybe we can reach out. I'll see about reaching out to the Pennsylvania. They've got a great organization. They've been doing it for years. Lots of training videos out there, and maybe having one of them on to talk about what they're doing, HF and VHF, UHF, and really been the pioneers in that area. So bring them in and have a look and see what they're doing.
Yeah, because I was barely aware of it, and I thought it had something to do with NV near vertical incidence HF antennas and stuff, and it turns out there's nothing to do with that. I'm not sure why I made that connection.
Oh, I'm sure they're using it for some of it, but the nice thing about that software is that you can really use it across the spectrum, and it does support so many different modes.
Yeah.
You do with it what you want. When you first brought it to our group 2 or 3 years ago, there were a lot of guys saying, well, we're already using this for contesting in DX, in RTTY and some of the other modes as well. And it's okay. Well, that's great. Part of your toolbox, and we'll expand the functionality of some of that more. And it's even better if you already know how it works.
Yeah. And the thing that people may not be catching immediately from it, but that I've recognized, because there's a corollary or a similar software in D-Star called D-Rats and probably yep. a few others, is the idea is if you're standardizing things as forms, you don't have to send the whole form. You
right.
send a small amount of information that the software knows how to populate back into a form on the other end, which narrows down how much is being sent. So on some of our skinnier data modes, and most of our data modes are pretty skinny, you keep the amount of stuff that gets sent down to a minimum. And yet it's displayed on the other end as a fully populated ordinary form that the EMS folks or the emergency management folks are used to seeing.
Right. So, right. And it's great. It's great. You print one of those out and you hand it to somebody and they look at it like, wow, where did you get this? How'd you get this all together looking so professional and not chicken scratch?
Yeah.
So it's a good thing.
But the concept of the multiple ways there are to do things. Mm-hmm. And it, on the one hand, within ham radio, it's great to experiment and to develop and to progress and to have all kinds of possibilities as to ways to do things and to improve the things that we do. On the other hand, you need some stability. You need to get folks on board to actually get a job done.
Yeah.
And if you're going to improve and make an advancement, everybody's got to improve and make an advancement at the same time. And getting people to decide, yes, this is the way we're going to do it, and then this is the way we are going to make the next change, that's hard.
Sure, absolutely. And the two interviews we did today kind of proved that out. Most of the traffic, most of the stuff they did,
all on, you know, all FM and all voice. And that's great that it still fulfills the need. Hopefully we can, you know, keep upping the game and adding some of these other functionalities.
Yeah.
And like I said, those folks in Pennsylvania, they're running a lot of their stuff that way. In fact, I think that they do field day, I think exclusively on FL Digi, and they're like competitors. I mean, they turn in huge numbers.
I've never heard of anybody trying to do that. Just do it all digital.
They're all running. Well, you know, it's over the analog using the laptop software to make, you know, RTTY and other mode contacts. So yeah, we'll look into that and bring it together.
Yeah. RTTY, probably mostly PSK31. I think that's the big digital mode for field day these days, but all their stations, that's all they're running. There are no sideband, no CW.
I remember 2 years ago, I think that's 100% of what they're turning in. And they're committed to it. And I think that's awesome.
Yeah. Interesting. All right. That will be it for this episode. It is the EmComm Extra number 2, Ham Radio Now 274. Let me switch to my full screen camera. Oh, wait. Arvin is still visible on the split screen.
There you go.
There he is.
He's up there.
There he is back there. Helping me to pay for all of this infrastructure. Oh, there you are. You're on.
Yep.
Yeah. It's like Doctor Who. HamRadioNow.tv is the place to go if you enjoy the programs and can help with the infrastructure. Just look for Arvin's icon down at the bottom of the page. Get to the contribution page and you can help us out. A Patreon for a monthly contribution, a credit card, plain old credit card, or PayPal, which you can do credit card or your PayPal account. I want to also mention Ham Radio Now is available as an audio podcast, and this is probably going to be a pretty good radio show. So if you have a hard time sitting around watching your computer screen or even the big screen TV, this is one to pop some popcorn for, you know, prop your feet up and watch all this stuff go by. But I find it a whole lot easier to listen to podcasts, even the ones that start as video, like all the stuff on Twit. A lot easier to listen to them while I'm doing other stuff. So we are available that way, and you can subscribe. And easy instructions. But just pick up your phone and go to the podcast app on your phone and search Ham Radio Now, HamRadioNow. And you'll find us. If you don't, for some reason, find us, go to the website and click on the audio button, and it'll show you how to get it into your phone. And you'll be the first one to know when there's a new episode, because I get the audio out first by a couple of hours. And it's time to say goodbye. So thank you, David. We'll be back for another EmComm Extra in the near future. 73, back to the split screen, 73, everybody. I am Gary Pierce, KM4AQ.
And I am David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
Over.
And?
Out. Wasn't sure you were going to do the out part or not. When it's only two,
I wasn't sure either.
You can do the out part.
Okay.
Stop the tape.